Hello and welcome to Cinema Express. My name is Ram Venkat Srikar. Today we have with us filmmaker and cinematographer David Bolen. His IMDb says he has nearly over 100 credits as cinematographer across documentaries, short films, feature films, and TV shows. You must have seen his work in shows like Trail by Media, I Was a Teenage Villain, and the most popular one in India is the second season of Delhi Crime. His latest work, the documentary, the New York Times op opinion doc, The Best Chef in the World, it came out a few weeks back and it's amazing. You guys should check it out. Hi, David. How are you?
I'm really good. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
I was reading an interview of yours where you had stated that two cinematographers, one Sean Bobbitt and second Bradford Young, were your biggest cinematic influences. Can you elaborate a bit more on how they influenced your work?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, cinematography has always been a very kind of like intuitive, feeling-based art form. And I think, you know, the parts of cinematography that I actually really don't like are all the kind of technical things. Like those are things that I think are important, and like I obviously understand them, and I know how to use them to kind of get the image I want. But I always hate when cinematography takes too far of a technical form. You know, it's like what attracts me about cinematography is the feelings you create with the images, and I think Bradford Young and Sean Bobbitt are just two DPs who have always, when they talk about cinematography, they're not talking about cameras, they're not talking about f-stops, they're not talking about shutter, they're talking about feelings and the mood and the thing they want their images to convey. And they always do it in this really beautiful way where it feels super clear. So yeah, specifically like Sean Bobbitt, you know, he came from a documentary background similar to mine. He was doing war photography and he was doing news broadcasts, which is kind of wild. And he brought that to his kind of narrative work. So when you watch films like Place Beyond the Pines, you're like, whoa, this film feels so real and visceral. Why is that? And it's because he's bringing this like documentary approach where he's covering things in a very organic way where it almost just feels like they were like, let the actors go. And he just ran around with the camera and did it. And you know, lighting things 360 where the actors can just, if they want to go to the corner, they can go to the corner. If they want to go to the kitchen, they can go to the kitchen, and he'll just kind of follow around. So that's always been really important to me, because I think letting actors roam is such a beautiful gift you can give them. And they do amazing things when they have that ability rather than just going to a specific mark. And then Bradford Young, I think is just like I think he's one of the most special artists we have. You know, his lighting, his composition, all the things he does. I just feel like everything he shoots, like every frame looks like a painting. And again, he talks about cinematography in this soulful way. It's never technical. It's always about what's the mood I'm trying to convey here. And he's just been a huge inspiration in terms of not just how I like, you know, obviously I use him as reference point, but I think just in terms of the way I think about cinematography, he's really important.
Wonderful. I really like the fact that you place the feelings over technicality. Do you remember the very first time you were fascinated with the medium?
Yeah, I mean, I think I was really lucky because my parents were so supportive, and my mom loved movies and you know, loved making movies. And so she gave me a camera when I was super young. She has this like photo of me as like a toddler with like a running around with a camera. So I think it was just inherent in my life. And I was fortunate to have like a dad who would take me to the movies every Tuesday, and we would go see some obscure art film and something I probably shouldn't be watching. And so I kind of had this love of movies from a very, very, very young age, and was like super fortunate that they were supportive of me kind of like taking this route. So I was lucky, because I feel like a lot of people don't have that, you know, it's like go be a doctor or something, but my parents were always like, yeah, if you want to make movies, you should go do that.
Wonderful. Do you remember any movies that left a very visceral impact on you?
Yeah, I mean, so many. Specifically, it's funny, like one of the most profound movie experiences of my life, I was pretty young when I saw this. I can't remember when it came out, but it was this film called Babel by Inarritu.
Oh yeah, 2006. Yeah,
2006. Yeah, so let's see. I'm 31 now, so that would have been what? That's 18 years ago. So
yeah,
I must have been 11 or 12. And my dad took me to see Babel, and I just remember being in that theater and being like so blown away and immersed. And that was a film where I really like learned the power of subjectivity, which is another really important tool in a cinematographer's toolbox, is like being subjective with your characters and telling the story from a specific point of view. And there's this incredible storyline in Babel with this woman in Tokyo who can't hear.
Yeah.
And I remember watching this sequence where she's taking drugs and she's hanging out with friends, and they're having this really visceral experience in the middle of Tokyo and playing in a playground. And then they go to this club and there's all this noise and sound and light, and all of a sudden it cuts to a shot of her and it cuts to a shot of what she's seen, and the sound cuts out and you can't hear anything. But everyone's dancing and the party's going on, but you're within her kind of space, you know, headspace. And I remember just watching that and being like, whoa, this is an incredible thing you can do with movies, where you can really go inside from the point of view. And so that's a huge thing for me. I'm always talking with directors. I'm saying, oh, what's the subjectivity of this? Which character are we with? Whose point of view are we trying to show? I think it's a really important thing to think about when you're telling stories.
Okay. So lovely. Although you say that the technicality doesn't fascinate you as much as the emotions, your Insta stories, I follow you on Instagram, and you keep posting about the kind of the different cameras you work with for each project. How do you pick these toys? Like, I'm sure that's quite technical, right? If you how do you pick these toys?
Yeah, and it's not to say, I think the technical parts are really important, because there's kind of two things. It's like you can have an image in your head of what you want to capture, and I think that's the most important thing. But if you don't know how to get there and what you need to do to the image to make it look like that, then what's the point, right? I think as a DP, you're always really like, everyone can imagine what they want things to look like, but as a DP, your journey is really about getting there. The closer you are to that image in your head, that's when you kind of achieve success. And I'm still not even there, right? I have images in my head where I'm like, I know what I want it to look like, but I get 95% of the way there, but not the last 5%, you know?
Not even once?
Every now and then, but it's like lightning in a bottle with images, right? It's such a, I feel like you're always striving to make it better, and it's always not quite exactly what you want, but you get close. But I think there's very few DPs who kind of get it perfect. With cameras, for me, it's like funny. Cameras are such a, there's the cameras I love and that I prefer. But for me, cameras have always been something that's very much like a practicality thing in terms of what allows me to move quickly, what allows me to move without having to bring a ton of giant lights on set. Those things are really important, because again, like, I think there are DPs who love the idea of having, you know, a bunch of 18Ks spread across the sky. And for me, that's always been like something where it's actually restrictive. I've always been like, how can I use the least amount of light? How can I let the actors move as much as possible? How can I have the least amount of gear in the room so that this space feels real and that my stuff isn't getting in the way of what we're creating, right? So yeah, I mean, the cameras I love shooting on the Alexa. I think it's the most beautiful digital camera out there. But I love shooting on film when I can, you know. I love shooting on 16, I love shooting on 35. Those things.
Did you have a chance to shoot on film?
Yeah, and I mean I have a couple 16 millimeter cameras. I own like an SR3 and a Bolex, and I think it's tough. I mean, in India, I remember talking to a few producers about it, and they just said it's really challenging because there's no development labs, which I always found. Yeah, it's just upset. It's too bad, because, you know, there are things that you can achieve with film that just don't work with digital. But we are lucky in the States that in LA there are a couple labs left and you can still do it, but it's expensive.
Okay.
But in terms of digital, I love the Alexa, and I'm about to I've been testing the Alexa 35, which has been a really impressive new camera to come out. And it's amazing in low light, and it gives you a lot of extra resolution and a lot of extra latitude. So I'm about to start a new project with that camera, which should be exciting.
I find this quite intriguing, and I would like to know where does the film gain that edge over digital?
You know, I try not to think of it as like an edge. I think it's to me, it's just a different aesthetic, and certain things are right for different projects. But film for me, it's like an image. It's funny. I think of an image as a texture, you know, and that's why I think really clean cinematography has always been like something I hate. Like and it's not to say I hate the look of like Marvel films, but there's a lot of films that I just feel like they lack a certain textural quality where you feel like you can like feel an image. You know, when something's perfectly clean, it's really challenging for me. So like, I love grain and I love artifacts and I love distortion and I love all these things you can do to kind of distort an image. That's where Bradford Young strives, is like his images have this texture where it almost feels like you can like taste the image. It has so much going for it. It's something that's really hard to describe, but this grain and the aberrations that film creates and the kind of imperfections where the light does strange things and where the edges of an image kind of fade away and all these things where the image kind of feels like it has a life of its own. Those things are kind of magical to me, and you create a mysticism with an image rather than it being this clear thing. You know, I think stories are, you know, my favorite stories are myths and fables. And if you imagine a fable in your head and someone's telling a story, if you're by a campfire and someone's telling you a story, it's not this crystal clear thing. It's this kind of mysterious thing. And I think with cinematography, I'm trying to create mysterious images. I'm trying to create images that aren't perfectly clear, but have this kind of mysticism to them.
Phil, what you just said, I find it wonderful. The fact that you look for a certain degree of flaws or imperfect things. You really must have loved Mr. Eric's work in Mank, right? Because
that's a
film. Yeah. You've been to USC, you studied there, but you have worked a lot in documentary filmmaking, right? Documentary filmmaking. I'm not sure. I would like to know from you, from the theory that you have learned in film school, how much of it did you actually get to use in documentaries? Because documentaries, not everything is choreographed in documentaries, right? It's all about the spontaneity. So how did you put your experience from the films, your learnings from the film school on a documentary project?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I mean, I think what film school, like film school, unless you go to very specific film schools, it's so much less about it doesn't really teach you the technical things that you need. You know, it gives you a basic understanding. For the most part, I find that film school, at least in the United States, is a much more theory-based kind of thing where it's kind of teaching you like what does this sort of angle imply psychologically in an audience? Like you kind of get taught the things of like, if you shoot it someone from a high angle, you're making them look like less in control. From a low angle, they have power. And dominance, like those kind of things, which it's funny when I look back at like my old short films, it's like my angles are so extreme because I'm always trying to like evoke something very specific with my angles. And I think the more you shoot, it's funny, the more you are drawn towards naturalism. And kind of getting out of the way and just creating a mood with your image, but not trying to be too forceful in terms of what you're implying with it, because it just becomes to be too much. But in terms of like how I brought kind of the things I learned to documentary, it's always there in the back of your head. And I think with documentary, you're responding really quickly and you're responding on a highly emotional level, and you have to make decisions very quickly. So it's like when I'm in a room and two people are arguing on camera, it's all instinctual and I'm covering in a very specific way where I'm feeling things and I'm finding the angles and I'm, oh, there's a silhouette there that feels right for this moment. Oh, I'm I just want to be close on her eyes right now. And you're making those decisions really quickly. And it's not like I'm thinking in my head, oh, you know what? I should be doing this because I remember this thing from film school where they said that if I get this kind of shot, it'll mean this. But it is there with you in the back of your mind. I think all the things you learn on your journey, it informs you and it allows you to make those decisions really quickly. Where now when I'm on a documentary set, it's rare that I question my judgment. It's something that's so inherent in my mind of how I'm going to shoot this. So I think all those lessons you learn, they help you just move quicker in documentary and do your job easier.
When you're working on narrative features, I'm sure you get say adequate or optimal time for pre-production, right? Mm-hmm. How do documentaries have this concept of pre-production, especially from a cinematography perspective?
Well, it's funny with docs because like, When you shoot a narrative, like I'm prepping a narrative feature right now, like, and I'm about to start, and I hate pre-production. Like you can dream and you can plan and you can, it's a logistical thing and you're scheduling and you're planning and you're thinking about shots and you're looking at references. But for me, it's like, until you get on that set and you see the light, and you see the actor's face and you see it all in one place, you never know what you're going to do. And it's like, I can have a very vivid idea of what I think the movie will look like, but until I get in there, I get the camera up, it won't become super clear. It becomes crystal clear the moment you start recording. And with documentary, what I love is that it's almost this, like specifically with this one documentary filmmaker I work with quite a bit, Lance Oppenheim.
Yeah,
you're kind of in a never-ending phase of pre-production because we start shooting and we don't quite know what it looks like, and we're kind of figuring it out, and then we find that, oh, this thing's working, oh, this is working. Like, what if we shot it all really wide, and then what if we actually did slow zooms at specific moments that where the characters are going through something, and kind of over time, as we continue shooting, it starts to crystallize what the film really should look like. So it's kind of, I like that idea of like, of pre-production while in production, you know, like you're kind of figuring out the film while you're actually shooting it.
And learning on the go.
Yeah, that's really exciting to me because it's super intuitive. Like I've never gone into a documentary knowing exactly what it would look like. It's always been this process of like finding it and experimenting and like trying things and like throwing things at a wall, seeing what sticks. So I like enjoy that process. Like I think pre-production on a narrative scale is always a little frustrating because I just want to get the camera out there and try some things and see what works, you know, and just play, you know. I like playing, I like experimenting.
Since you spoke of Lance's, your collaboration with Lance, I can't quite recall the documentary's name, but you guys did a fantastic documentary about aviation employees living.
Oh yeah, long-term parking, yeah.
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely phenomenal work. There is a point where a subject breaks down, right? There is a point where he breaks down. You're capturing these intimate moments. Like they are completely unplanned.
Yeah.
What runs in your mind when something profound is happening in front of you, but it's completely unplanned? Do you think that's the reward of working in a documentary as opposed to a narrative feature where everything is choreographed?
Yeah, I mean, there's just certain moments on documentary sets where it doesn't happen often, but where you don't expect it to happen, but something amazing happens in front of you that you can't believe. And those moments are like really special. And if you have the light is right and the camera's in the right place and something dramatic is happening, it's like, it's such a magical thing. And in a way it's like a drug. It's like that sort of feeling as an artist of capturing something like that in real time is such a crazy thing to do. And those are things you can't capture in narrative, right? I can be touched by a performance, but at the end of the day, you know, this is an actor and this isn't real. And, you know, you kind of knew it was going to happen. In documentary, when something like profound happens in front of camera that you weren't expecting, it's like, it's a crazy feeling. And I think what makes documentary storytelling so special.
Do you remember what was running in your mind when that happened while making Long Term Parking?
I think honestly, I try to just stay in the headspace of like, what is this character going through, and how can I convey this in a way that's emotional and not exploitative and not, you know, I think reality TV, what they do, you know, as soon as something dramatic happens, the camera's getting right up in their face. And for me, it's kind of about being quiet, and you find the shot and you let it happen and you let that moment pass, and you try and capture it in a way where you're not intruding with this person, you know? Yeah. I think it's always about, with docs, it's always about like compassion and, you know, whoever the person is, good or bad, finding like the beauty in their story and trying to portray it in a meaningful way.
Now that some of the documentaries that you have worked on so far are so like intimate profiles of people, at what point do you enter these documentaries? Because from a filmmaking perspective, when a filmmaker is interviewing a subject, they must have built a rapport with that person, right? In order to draw those long emotional responses. As a cinematographer, when do you associate with a project? At what point?
Yeah, I mean, I think especially on long form docs, and I've been doing a lot more series as of late and feature docs. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you get incredibly, incredibly close with people. It's like, it's kind of impossible not to, because you're just spending so much time with them. So yeah, like on a film, me and Lance did a film called Some Kind of Heaven, which is this narrative feature in Florida. And you know, you're spending like 4 or 5 months with these people, seeing them like almost every other day and just being in their homes. And, you know, they become some of your like closest friends. It's like, it's kind of insane. You know, a lot of the people on that film, I feel like they're like my second parents, you know, because wow. You're just seeing them so often and you're in these really intimate settings with them. And I'm capturing parts of their lives that are really vulnerable parts. And I think as a DP, especially in docs, it's like, it's almost part of your job to build those relationships, and not in an artificial way, in a way that's real, mm-hmm. but you're never going to capture something intimate unless the people feel safe with you. And unless they feel like you're going to capture them in a way that is realistic and not exploitative and, you know, doing them justice. So right. I think it's your job to, yeah, become friends with them and get close with them and feel compassion for them, you know?
I believe that the fundamental difference that sets apart these both mediums is the staging, right? In a documentary, yeah. Everything is instantaneous. It can't be staged. In narrative, yeah. You have the liberty to stage. Like, it might be liberty for some, it might be a restriction for some. How different, according to you, or how much does your craft change based on the medium?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny. It definitely changes a lot. Hmm. You know, on docs, I'm not really using lights. I'm letting people move organically. I'm doing all those things. But I definitely try to bring similar aspects of my work from documentary into narrative. So if we think of Delhi crime, right?
Yeah.
In a way, Delhi crime is like a very realistic show. The whole feel is supposed to feel realistic and gritty and moody. And, you know, there's kind of three types of light that I'm using for the most part. Not always, but for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
You're using practical lights. So I'm using lamps that are in a room. I'm using fluorescent tubes. I'm using things that would actually exist in the space. I'm using that as a light source. And often that's, you know, a lot of the time when you're in small homes, that's going to be your only light source because you don't have anywhere else to hide a light.
No more external lighting?
Oh, depends. But a lot of the time, I'd just be using practicals. If you're like, okay, well, this is a tiny room, I'm going to turn on a lamp and the lamp is going to light them beautifully. And as long as I'm on the right side of the lamp and they're getting some silhouette to them, then great. It really works. Like, there's so many scenes in Delhi crime that are literally just a lamp. You'd be amazed. Yeah. The second source of light that I'm using is from windows, from outside, you know? So whether that's me augmenting that with my own sunlight and blasting that in, Or if that's just natural daylight coming through that maybe I'm manipulating or shaping a little bit, maybe I'm diffusing it a bit, depending on the mood. And then the third thing I'm doing, which really is space dependent on how big the space is I'm putting up speed rail on the ceiling and I'm keeping it hidden out of view. And I'm adding little sources here. Like, you know, for me, it's all about backlight. I'm always trying to backlight characters and add those rims to them. So when I can fit it, I'm lighting from above and hiding my actual film lights there. But that can be really tricky, especially when you're doing like wonders and you're moving through spaces and you're seeing the whole thing. So it just is very dependent. And then, you know, if there is a scene where people are just sitting and it's a bit more controlled, that's when I'll bring in my stands and my lights and do some proper key lights. But with Delhi Crime, a lot of the time you're moving through these spaces and you're moving with the characters and you're going from one room to another, then you're going outside and you're kind of just trying to let them roam free. So you're really trying to create these little pools of light. And a lot of the times that's just with practicals and being strategic, being like, oh, the actor might go there. Let's get some lamps there. Let's get a fluorescent tube here. Let's put a little light through the window here. And then you kind of just let them move through these pockets. And with the actors, you're collaborating and you're saying, oh, Shefali, I know you really want to go there, but like, you'll actually look a lot better if you walk towards that window there. And what's great about her and all the actors in Delhi Crime is they get that. They're super willing to kind of work with me and get into those little pockets of light, but still allow them to move. You know, for me, it's all about movement and not having the actors be too stagnant.
I find it quite fascinating that you also shot a film called Sony, which is also set in Delhi, which is also about women navigating through their life. So when you shot, and I don't know, is that one of the reasons have you got the opportunity to shoot Delhi Crime? Because is that the case?
Yeah, I mean, I think, it's funny. I'd have to go back and ask Tanuj exactly what he saw, but I imagine Sony had something to do with it. It is strange that both my kind of projects in India have been about female police officers in Delhi. It's kind of an obscure thing to do, but I think they must have seen that.
So I absolutely love Sony, those long takes. So the film basically doesn't have any cuts, right? Every scene is a sequence. There are no cuts inside those sequences. So is this I feel that even in Sony you had approached it like a documentary. There are no curves and like the 360 degree lighting that you just mentioned. So it's pretty much like you applied your documentary experience in Sony. Is that right?
Yeah, it's funny in a way. Like Sony is kind of meant to feel like a documentary, but in a way, because of the 360 nature of, you know, because we were shooting long takes and every scene was a wonder, in a way it was like a very technically challenging project. You know, it is a documentary feel, but it's like there's a lot of hidden things that went into it, right? So especially when you're moving from one space to another and then you're going outside and you're trying to hide camera shadow and you're trying to get rid of reflections and you're trying to make your presence not known. It gets to be quite challenging and stressful and you know, a lot of times you're not figuring out the actual take until the very last hour of the day and then you're rushing to get it right. So doing like a film like that, it's a wonderful experience, but it's not something I recommend to everyone. It's a very stressful process, but definitely rewarding. And yeah, I mean, with us, with Sony, the long takes were just, we were trying to create a sense of realism with it where the movie really felt like it was happening in real time with real people. And hopefully it was successful. I mean, it's if I look back at that film now, and I can't even remember when we shot that, but it must have been almost 7 years ago now.
Really?
I remember looking back at it a couple months ago and just, you know, all I could see were the mistakes. Like I it's been so long, but it was so vivid in my head, just like the things we did wrong. But at the end of the day, I think it's a beautiful film, specifically just because you have wonderful performances by these two lead actresses. So no, it's a special film for me, and it's a film that brought me to India, and India is a place that I think has become very meaningful in my life and a place I love shooting. So yeah, I'm super grateful for that experience.
Sony is indeed one of the best Indian films to come out in recent times. After working on Sony, did you find Delhi Crime to be a more liberating experience as a cinematographer, because you obviously had more resources and time this time?
It was, there were more resources and we had more money and but we went through a lot on that production, which made it really challenging, because we started shooting that in January 2020. And you know, midway through production, the pandemic set in. And you know, that was a really stressful time, where I remember we were going, you know, from our hotel, and in February it was this packed hotel. And by the end of February it was getting a bit quieter, and then early March and the hotel was a dead zone, and we're still shooting, and you're kind of like, what's going on here? It was kind of a troubling feeling, and I remember having to like quickly leave the country. You know, production got shut down. You know, at lunch we thought we were going, and by the end of the day the producers were like, oh, it's getting too crazy, and we shut down. And the next morning I was on a flight home. It's like a very jarring experience. So we had a lot of struggles on that production, in the sense that we didn't have this really fluid A to B production where we could get in a super clear flow. But what was nice about the pandemic is it gave us time to like evaluate what we had gotten. Like, okay, how can we make this even better? What's working and what's not? And that I think is really powerful, because there are things that changed and things that developed in different storylines that we're like, oh, this is more important or less important. So having that extra time was really valuable. But yeah, no, I loved shooting on Delhi Crime. I love the style of it. I think what they did with season one was just incredible. And Richie and Johan, the DP, are some just incredible artists. I think Johan's work is beautiful and amazing, and what he created in season one gave me such a template to build off of. So yeah, I loved it.
So Delhi Crime 2, obviously a substantial chunk of it is shot in real locations as well, right? You have to use the space, that the real space, like make sure that the lighting, you're lighting up for the whole space. How challenging does it become when you're shooting in outdoors, in real locations, with the crowd especially?
It's funny, I personally love real locations. We did the police station on a set, and so that was all built. But I love real locations in the sense of, like, you find these beautiful things that you could never recreate on a stage. You know, sometimes you walk into a location and you're scouting it, and you see the way the light comes in at 5 p.m. and it's moving through a bunch of leaves, and or maybe it's reflecting off of some mirror in the courtyard, and it's creating this refracted light in the space, and you're like, wow, like that's beautiful. Like, how can we incorporate that? And you can kind of be like, okay, well, let's shoot the scene at 5 p.m. and let's actually use the natural light that's coming in. So I always find that there's this magical element to real locations. And yeah, it's frustrating sometimes, and you're dealing with location owners, and you're you know, you have these struggles of, oh, you can't actually shoot there, and you know, when you try and put up lights, sometimes there's conversations of like, oh, we can't rig this, we can't do that, and you have to work around that, and that can be frustrating, especially when you're in a rush. But I think the magic that real locations brings is amazing. And I, you know, for me, I just hate when things feel fake and on a stage. You know, hopefully the police station felt real, but a lot of the time on a stage you're fighting, you know, trying to make the windows look real and trying to make the space feel real, and I am always fighting that sense of artificiality. So when you're on real locations, it's going to look real, you know.
What is it about India that fascinates you, from purely from a cinematography perspective?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny, because I feel like I actually don't know India all that much. It's I've only been to Mumbai and Delhi. I mean, I've been to India, I think, 5 or 6 times now on between the two shoots, but I've only been to Mumbai and Delhi. So I think I have a very basic understanding of India as a whole, but specifically what I can speak to is Delhi. You know, I feel like I've been to every corner of Delhi at this point with location scouting and just the amount I've shot there. I really know that city. And, you know, if we go back to the mysticism I was talking about earlier, Delhi has this quality to it where, you know, specifically at night when you're driving through Delhi, it has this almost supernatural quality to it that is unexplainable. There's so many different types of people and there's this energy and this mood, and it you know, for me visually, it's a really exciting place, and it feels like a mysterious place, and if at time it feels like a really dark place. It has a lot of things going on where you're like, what's going on in that alley, what's going on behind this corner, and that fascinates me visually. And kind of the difference between Delhi in the day and Delhi at night, you know, where Delhi feels like this kind of almost governmental city. It feels very proper in the day. And then as soon as the sun goes down, it feels like this kind of, it almost feels a bit like Gotham, you know? So I've always been fascinated by Delhi as a place. And I think Tanuj as well, the showrunner, has this fascination with Delhi. And, you know, we loved exploring it. And on a deeper level with India, this isn't just to like hype India up, but I think the crews in India are just outstanding. It's like some of the best gaffers and focus pullers and technicians I've ever worked with in production design, like unbelievable what they can pull off. My gaffer and my AC on Delhi Crime were just like some of the best I've ever worked with. So I'm super appreciative to them and what they helped me achieve, because like nothing was impossible to them. If you asked for something crazy, they would make it happen.
What are some of your favorite scenes from sequences from Delhi Crime 2?
No, yeah, I think it's honestly, it's so vivid in my mind. I mean, specifically, we can give a spoiler alert now, just in case you haven't seen it, I'm going to spoil
some stuff. Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, episode 5, the final episode, there's this chase sequence between Shefali and you know, we're moving through these alleyways and they're kind of chasing and trying to find her, and afterwards they have this conversation in this police jeep, and they're just staring at each other, and they're in the back of a police jeep, so their faces are this close together and they're just looking at each other, and I'm just there in the back of the jeep just capturing it. And I remember we shot that in March 2020. And, you know, I think we're all in a super dark headspace because you're seeing the news reports every day. It was one of our last shoot days before we got shut down. And so there's this darkness in the entire crew. And I remember it was pouring rain, and we had all these lights everywhere, and it was a really difficult night. And, you know, we were all feeling things, and we got in that police jeep, and the way the light fell on their faces, and it was raining, and you could see the rain outside the police jeep kind of creating this texture. And then they just gave these incredible performances. And I remember being in the eyepiece, and I can't even speak Hindi, you know, it's like, I understand it just because the script I get translated. So I know what's happening in a scene, but I remember just feeling like so deeply emotional while shooting that, you know, 'cause it felt like the end of this journey, and we're shooting this climactic scene, and I'm just watching these two actors give like some of the best performances I've ever seen. And there's all of these things kind of came together. And I think the things I was feeling at that time are totally put into the way I lit and composed that scene. So that's like a perfect thing with cinematography, is when you can feel things and that feeling is coming out in your work. That's when you're kind of onto something.
Wonderful. What's next for you, David? What's happening?
Yeah. So I've been in prep. I'm in LA at the moment, and I've just been on prep on a narrative feature. So I'm about to start a new project that we're going to shoot on the Alexa 35 and play with that new camera. And then we'll see. I mean, I definitely am hoping to get back to India soon and shoot something else there. And Tanuj, who directed season 2, is a wonderful filmmaker and one of my closest friends, and he has a lot of projects that, you know, he's dreaming up in both in India and the States. So hopefully we'll be doing more soon, and I think I'll continue to shoot docs and And
wonderful.
I'm going to be excited by that. So, yeah.
Perfect. My final question would be, just looking at your IMDb, your filmography, just makes me wonder how many days you must be working every year, right? There's just too much work that you're doing, and too many experiences that you're accumulating in this journey, that I even feel, sometimes I even feel envious, because I was going through your website. So for this film called When Lions Became Lions, you got to shoot with the hunter. So it's just brilliant how many experiences you are amassing. So what keeps you going? Don't you ever get tired? Like, I'm just talking about the sheer physicality of the work involved here.
Yeah, I mean, I think I've honestly, over the past couple of years, I've tried to slow down a little and be a bit more kind of selective with the projects, and realize that, you know, you're going to do your best work when you're in a really good headspace and a more well-rested headspace. You know, I think when I was younger, I was so excited by everything, and I just wanted all those experiences, and I would just go from project to project. I would never stop. And it was rare, you know, that I got more than 5 hours of sleep a night, because I was just always on the go and always traveling. And that's a beautiful thing about documentaries, is like you gain so many kind of weird life experiences where you're hanging out with people that you would have never hung out with in your life. And that's where I think a lot of kind of empathy comes from, is getting to know different people, and getting to know that even bad people, they have a reason for why they do the things they do. And it comes from their situation most of the time, and their circumstances, and understanding that has been like a really important thing in my life. Because, you know, once you know that, then you can connect with people much better. But yeah, I'm trying to slow down, and I think cinematography is not a particularly good thing for someone trying to have a great personal life. Like, it's really hard to build those long relationships when you're on the go all the time. So it's something, now I'm 31, I'm finally trying to like slow down a little and be like, okay, what are the 4 or 5 projects a year that I really want to put my heart and soul into and create something. So yeah.
And you can also afford to turn down projects now, right?
Yeah, you can afford to turn them down, and I think more than that, it's about, you know, someone said to me recently, like, every feature film you do, it's like a tattoo. It's like going to remain with you, and people are going to think of you, associate you with that feature film. So, you know, in the past, I might have been excited, oh, it's a feature film, I should do this, like, you know, maybe the script has some issues, but, you know, it's exciting, it's a feature film. And now it's taking a step back and really being like, okay, A, is the script good? Is the director good? But B, can I bring something emotionally to this where it's really representative of who I am as a person, and what I want to convey with my images? And, you know, you got to have all those elements for it to be a successful piece, right? And I don't think it's fair for me to take on a project if I'm not emotionally attached to it. So I really try and be a lot more kind of considerate when I read scripts now, and think, okay, am I feeling something while I'm reading this? And if I'm not feeling something, I probably shouldn't be doing this. Like, I need to be really emotionally invested in order to create meaningful images. That's something I've like learned over time. If I don't feel anything, then my images aren't going to be good on set. So yeah.
What's one advice that you would give to aspiring photographers or cinematographers from your own experiences?
Yeah, I mean, it's so funny. Like, I feel like, you know, I do get a lot of young DPs reach out to me and want to talk. And it's so funny. So many of their questions are technical. And it's like, oh, what camera did you use? What lenses did you use? What light did you use? And it's always like, I'm always so confused by that, because it's, you know, I can shoot on an Alexa with master primes, or I could shoot on a Sony Venice with super speeds, or I could shoot on a Red with Cook lenses. And I could make all of those images look almost exactly the same. It's not about the camera or the lens. It's like people get so in their heads about that stuff. It's it's really about the way you're lighting and composing and the locations you're picking and the colors you're choosing. And all those design elements are so much more important than like the camera and lens and the light you're using. You know, people are asking me like, what ISO did you shoot that on? What white balance? And you're like, what? it's so crazy to me. So I think it's for me, it goes back to that first thing. It's like with cinematography, it's about emotion and it's about feeling things and it's about being present in that moment. And you're never going to create images that speak to people if you're not feeling things while you're on set. So whenever things get crazy on set and it gets logistical and it's like you're rushed on time and there's things going wrong, it's like I try and silence all of that. And I try and go in a headspace of what am I feeling right now emotionally with these characters, all these things, all this chaos on set, it doesn't matter. What's actually happening in the moment? What are we trying to convey? What is the mood we're trying to go for here? And I silence all that other stuff and you just think about that. And I think for young DPs, it's like, that's really important to remember is that at the end of the day, you're telling stories and stories are only successful if they're emotional. And you always have to be in that emotional state of mind. You can't be a technician. You have to be an artist. You know, all the best DPs, they're not technicians. They're artists.
Wow. Wonderful. On that note, thank you very much, David. Thank you very much for the time and for sharing these insights. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Great questions. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you.